Shalom Avarim, welcome friends in Hebrew. My name is Tony Pino, and today we would like to continue our discussion on the authenticity of the apostleship of Shaul, Paul. We would like to continue looking at his letters, specifically the term under the law. This is part four, and the Greek there is hupomnamon, and we are looking at it because sometimes you will come across people within the Messianic community that struggle with Shaul's letters, not understanding what he means, and it's very important that we look at the context and the historical setting of those letters. Very important that we understand they're not theological essays or some type of dissertation where Shaul is trying to earn his PhD in Jewish theology. No, they are letters being written about specific problems, and they are dealing with things after the resurrection of Yeshua. And so there has been an empowerment of the Ruach HaKodesh people. Yeshua has paid for our sins that we have committed, not just the sins that we commit, but also the sin of Adam. He paid for the penalty of death, which holds everybody on the ground. So we are looking at this terminology under the law because when some people who struggle with Paul's letters look at it, they might feel he contradicts himself. He's not following the Torah correctly, and they come to the conclusion he is a false teacher or false apostle through that type of lens looking at it. But we want to keep him in context. We want to keep him within that Second Temple Judaism setting that he wrote and understand the letters and people that he's writing these things to. And he's using Hebrew idioms, Hebrew slang terms that were very familiar to them that might not be so familiar to us in the 20th century. And so very important as we continue this study to look at this. Now, within starting this, we always want to start out with the blessing of salvation. We always want to give all praise and glory and honor to Yeshua HaMashiach, our Messiah, our Lord, our King, for he is the only way to the Father, and he gives eternal life. Amen. So if you know this blessing, go ahead and join in with me. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu, melech ha'olam, asher natan lanu et derech ha-Yeshua ba-Mashiach, Yeshua Baruch Hu. Blessed are you, Lord our God, King of the universe, who has made the way of salvation through the Messiah Yeshua. Blessed be his name. Amen. So last time we were together, in part three, we saw and went through some of the terms of works of the law, which again, in Greek, is hupomnamon. All right, hupo meaning beneath or under the authority of, and then namon meaning law. And when we talk about law, we are talking about the law of Adonai, the law of Moshe. It is a multifaceted terminology being used because it does speak of someone having to be under the law. In other words, it's something we must obey because it's Adonai's righteous standards within his kingdom. And it's his righteous standards on the earth. It displays his very character. But also we must understand that this term is multifaceted again, and it is used in a sense of being under the penalty of the law. You are under its penalty because obviously Shaul is very clear that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of Adonai, and the penalty that is due to him can only fully be paid through the blood of Yeshua, all right? The blood of animals and goats could not fully take away its power. It was given because and added to Israel because of their transgressions, amen? It was a way for them to maintain the relationship with Adonai so that they could maintain that relationship. And of course, Adonai knew his son would be coming to pay the full payment for it. All right, so the blood of bulls and goats in the book of Hebrews tells us that it cannot take away the power of sin. All right, it cannot fully pay for it. But like I said in the last teaching, it's kind of like a credit card. It was looked at, it was done, it was given because it was within the ability of the people. The people had the ability to follow that type of system where he set up the Levitical priesthood. And he set up the sacrificial system. It was within their power to do it, though they were stiff-necked, and they chose often not to follow it correctly. That was on them. But it allowed that to maintain the relationship until Yeshua came, he was the only one that was going to be able to permanently pay for the sins of all people and permanently take away the sin that Adam did in the garden, paying for the curse of death that is on the entire earth at that time. And so that was something that man could never do on his own. He could never earn that, do that. It's not even given in the law of Moshe as something that you could follow and then earn that type of gift. You could not reverse the curse of death. Only Yeshua could. And that's also what the law of Moshe pointed to, was we need a savior. We need something or someone given as a gift by Adonai to give us victory over sin in our life. And so that was the purpose, what we call, Hebrews says that it was a shadow and a type of the realities that was to come. And so, you know, again, we're looking at this and trying to keep all of this in context, because when you begin to understand Second Temple Judaism, you begin to understand the historical setting of that time, we can now put Shaul in the proper context from which he's writing these letters. You will see he never violates the Torah, tries to teach people to violate the Torah. You'll see that he follows right along with the teachings of Yeshua. And the lack of understanding usually comes with a lack of understanding Torah. That's where people really make the mistake. And within Second Temple Judaism, of course, when they say the law of Moshe, they also, in their mindset and at that time, included what we call halakha, oral law. All right, oral law was created by the rabbis and with the Sadducees, and it was needed, very much needed, because the Torah does not always explain everything on how everything is supposed to be done. And as we saw earlier in the teachings in Devarim, Deuteronomy, chapter 17, Adonai gave specific authority over to the judges and to the Sadducees, the priesthood. And so they were able to render decisions, and people were bound and binded to those decisions. Right? They could bind something to you or loose it from you according to the decisions that they make. And they would create halakha laws, oral laws, for the community to follow. And also within communities would rise up certain traditions. All right. The Parashim, the Pharisees, created certain traditions depending on where you were in the region. There was not just one Parashim. There were different Parashims from different areas, different schools, different rabbis. Not all of them agreed 100% on everything. All right. So they had different sects within the Pharisees. Something you always have to check out when you're looking at the words of Yeshua, which type of Pharisee was he talking to? They did not all believe exactly the same. They had different traditions amongst themselves. Also, you had different sects of Judaism. So what Judaism is being spoken of there? Just like within Christianity, we have different denominations. It was no different in the first century for Judaism. So these are all things you must take into account as you're reading Shaul's letters. That's something they would have fully understood because they lived it. They lived right in and amongst it. It didn't need to be explained to them. When you're writing or reading somebody else's mail, please understand they don't have to explain everything, because they're writing to a people that have certain amount of knowledge of the topic that they're talking about in the first place. So their letters are written in a way where they can use shorter terms, but in the mindset of the person reading it, they understand fully what that person is saying. So when we are looking at under the law, that person already knows it's multifaceted. It means walking in Torah, but it also can mean walking in the penalty of it. Are we still underneath the penalty of Torah in our lives, the sins that are in our lives? Are we underneath the curse of death if we're in Yeshua? And so we need to look at Huponamon, under the law, in that light, all right? And we're now continually going through it. We went through some of them in the last teaching, and now we're going to finish up looking at the term under the law in this teaching, and then in part five we'll move on to works of the law, which is used six times again within the scriptures, mainly in Galatians and Romans. Okay, And so we are walking through this, seeing that Shaul does not contradict himself. He is a true and authentic apostle of Yeshua. So last time when we were together, we looked and we ended with Galatians 4:21. And so we're moving on to the next time that under the law is used, and that is in Galatians 5:18. Galatians 5:18. Galatians 5:18 says this, "But if you are led by the Spirit, the Ruach in Hebrew, you are not under the law." So typically, a lot of times in Western Christianity, they've even misunderstood Paul, and sometimes within the Messianic world, they misunderstand Paul with this. And in stating this, they will say, "See, we have the Spirit. We don't need the law of Moshe anymore. We don't need to walk under the law, under walking in him." And within the Messianic world, they'll say, "See, Paul is contradicting the Torah. He's saying you're no longer underneath it. You don't have to obey it. You just have to obey the Spirit." That's what Paul's trying to say. But we do know that when we have this in proper context, that the Ruach HaKodesh was sent by Yeshua, would lead us into all truths. And so what would the Spirit empower you to do? He would empower you to keep the Torah. Amen. And so when you are listening, truly listening to the Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit, you will not disobey the Torah. You will follow in it according to the ways of Yeshua, according to how Yeshua taught us to live. And it's not just looking at the teachings of Yeshua, but we must look at how Yeshua lived. That's something that is often overlooked within Western Christianity. They just look at the teachings of him, but they don't look at how he lived. Did Yeshua keep the Sabbath? Yes, he did. The word fulfill there in keeping the Sabbath, when you say, "Oh, Yeshua fulfilled the Sabbath," yeah, every week he fulfilled it. And when it was done, he had to fulfill it again and fulfill it again. So the term fulfill there is often thought of as something done and then abolished away with. That's not the intent here, nor it is the proper way to render the Greek there. It is every time we come up against one of the laws of Moshe, we fulfill it. And then we do it again and we do it again. And we don't just do it once and it's done away. So when it says here, "But if you are led by the Spirit, the Ruach, you will no longer be under the law," it actually means under the penalty of the law, because you won't violate it. You violate the law when you don't listen to the Spirit, when you don't listen to him. And that's something we are still learning while we're here on earth. We're learning how to live in the kingdom. And so that is what Shaul's intent here in Galatians 5:18 is he's showing us that it's the Ruach HaKodesh that teaches us how to walk in Torah correctly, because he is from the Spirit of Yeshua. He is the Spirit of Messiah. And so he is showing us and leading us in the teachings of Yeshua, the proper way to follow Torah. And when you break it, you know that you have to repent and turn, because you're now under the penalty of it. You owe a wage, you owe a price. And so now you need to apply the blood of Yeshua to that sin that you do. So by violating loving your neighbor as yourself, by violating any of the laws that concern loving God, which would include the Sabbath and feast days and all of that, we need to repent from those sins and turn, learn how to follow them correctly according to the Ruach HaKodesh. And so this is the intent, of course, of what is going on here. When you look at the term huponamon in that multifaceted way of, yes, under the law of Moshe, but it also means a penalty for when we break it. What is the context going on here? What is being said? What is Shaul's purpose of this letter being said? And so that's what you need to constantly be looking at. So there is no contradiction here. He's not contradicting himself. He's actually upholding the words of Yeshua, because that's why we were sent the Comforter, to lead us and guide us into all truths. Amen. So now let's go on. We're going to move to the book of Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 20 through 21. We did go through this in an earlier teaching, but I want to go through it again because I want to stay with the flow of looking at all the times that under the law is being used. And so in this set of passages, it says this, 1 Corinthians 9, verses 20 through 21. To the Jews I became as a Jew, so that I might win Jews. To those who are under the law, as under the law, though not being myself under the law, so that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, as without law, though not being without the law of God, but under the law of Christ, so that I might win those who are without law. Amen. So, again, we're reading a letter. They understand these terminologies and how they are being used. It's that multifaceted way that we must, it can mean both at the same time. It can mean one or the other. And this will help you to see Shaul's flow in his letters. So, to the Jews, I became as a Jew. Again, oftentimes people will say, yeah, he followed the Torah when he was around the Jews because the Torah was given to the Jews, not the Gentiles. And so he did it when he was around there. And then when he was around the non-ethnic Jews, because they weren't given Torah, then he just didn't, you know, he ate pork. He didn't keep the Sabbath. You know, he just showed them the love of Yeshua, the love of Christ. And so then they were under the law of Christ in that way. And so we know that if that was what Shaul meant, he totally contradicted the Torah, the ways of Yeshua, because none of that follows in the way of how Yeshua taught, nor is that found in the Sinai covenant. Amen. That's not a truthful way of understanding this passage. At the Sinai covenant, both the Jew and non-ethnic Jew were welcomed into the kingdom, and they were all put under the Torah. They were all, as long as you connected and became a part of Israel, lived in the land of Israel, there was one Torah for all. So all had to follow the Torah. Amen. That would have meant that a non-ethnic Jew would have had to give up his pagan ways while he was living in the land of Israel. He would have had to follow the kosher laws. He would have had to come to synagogue on Shabbat. He would have had to learn the laws of Moshe. And he would have also learned that just because he dwelt in the land and was a part of Israel, it did not command him to be circumcised. He could live amongst them and follow the Torah without being circumcised. It was not a law that you had to be that way in order to be counted of an equal citizenship or be thought of as equal in the sight of the Torah. That was what later Judaism developed halakha laws and traditions where they forced circumcision and they forced conversion on you in order to be equal in their sight. And that was violating the Torah. And so that is something you won't find in the Torah. That was something developed by the rabbis. This is one of those paths that they got away from the truth of the Torah on. And so this is why Shaul often fights against forced circumcision, forced conversion to Judaism, because in that day that had all developed. That wasn't something around at the Sinai covenant. It wasn't given at the Sinai covenant. It developed over time. And so that is what Shaul is fighting within the book of Galatians. And so here we must have that type of understanding. And so what Shaul is actually saying here is when he goes to the Jews, he places himself in their shoes. He understands they fully know the way of Torah. He doesn't have to start with the beginning of Torah 101. This is what Torah means. This is how you start. They fully have been living it their whole lives. He can show them in the Tanakh where Yeshua fulfilled those passages. They know exactly what those passages are, what they mean. And he can prove Yeshua is the King of the Jews, that he is their Mashiach, their Messiah, through the methods within the Torah in a way a Jew would understand. And so it says here, to the Jews, I became as a Jew. I put myself in their shoes. I explained salvation through Yeshua in a way they would understand so that I might win Jews, it says. So those who are under the law as under the law. So not only are they under the law of Moshe, but they are under the penalty. The sacrificial system there is not sufficient to take away the power of sin in their life permanently. And so they are still under the penalty of the law. They're still under the penalty of the curse. The Sinai covenant never made a way for eternal salvation, eternal life. And so they are still under the penalty of the law in that sense. And so they need to take on the Messiah. They need to take on his sacrifice. And so that the power of sin can be defeated in their life through the moving of the Ruach HaKodesh. Ruach HaKodesh could fill them. They could walk in Torah in a way that they never have been able to do before. Amen. And so the power of the Ruach HaKodesh is a gift of grace by Adonai so that you can walk in Torah correctly. Walk it in the ways that Yeshua taught. And so this, as we go on, he says, to those who are under the law as under the law, though not being myself under the law. He's not saying he's not under the law of Moshe. He's saying he's not under the penalty of the law, that same power that they are, that those people who don't believe in Yeshua are. They don't have eternal life. They don't have the Ruach HaKodesh living inside of them. He's not under that penalty of the law of Moshe, though he proves all throughout the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 21, Acts chapter 25, verse 8, Acts 28, verse 17. He proves that he still continues to follow the law of Moshe. He never violates it in his teachings and how to teach others. And we know that within the law of Moshe, it did have the teaching of when you sin, what do you do? So it wasn't just following the law of Moshe perfectly and never sinning. It already had that sacrificial system teaching within it. And so now Shaul, he knows that when he breaks the Torah, that he just goes ahead and applies the blood of Yeshua now, okay, to his life. This did not mean that he didn't go to the temple and continue to give sacrifices. He did. He understood that that totally did not violate what Yeshua did on the cross. It actually helped teach people and show people that we need a Savior and that it is teaching others Adonai's method of receiving forgiveness, okay? And Adonai gave him that sacrificial system, right? But it was never meant to be something permanent. And that, again, he could use all of that to teach them about the blood of Yeshua. And so it's not that he stopped doing sacrifices. There's nothing wrong with the sacrificial system continuing. It was no threat to Yeshua. It was a gift given by Adonai at the Sinai covenant for them to maintain the relationship. And it could be still used as a useful tool to point you to Yeshua. So there's nothing wrong with it continuing. Many Western church people have the wrong impression that the reason why Adonai destroyed the temple and scattered, the Levitical priesthood and that, you know, no longer exists today, sacrifices no longer exist today. There's a misunderstanding that came about because of the work of Yeshua. That is a misunderstanding. Actually, the purpose for Adonai destroying the temple at that time was because of the corruption of the priesthood. All right, they weren't following the Torah correctly. It was an abomination in the way they were doing it. The Romans, they were in charge of who became high priest, so they weren't following the Torah in that way. The high priesthood was bought and sold, and you paid off the Romans, and the Romans put in place whoever they wanted. And then they had corruption within the priesthood. All you have to do is look at how many times they violated the Torah in how they treated Yeshua, how they found him guilty and put him to death. They were violating the Torah all along the way in that whole scenario of them taking him by night, that so-called trial, or there's many different ways people use that term that they did when they were bringing Yeshua before the Sanhedrin. It wasn't a full Sanhedrin. They had false witnesses. And so they were breaking the Torah all along. And so the reason for the destruction of the second temple is the same reason for the destruction of the first temple. Corruption. All right? Corruption. When you go to Jeremiah chapter 33, you will see and you can read that when Yeshua returns in the millennial time, not only will he be sitting on the throne, in Jerusalem, but also the priesthood will be back doing sacrifices, ministering before the Lord, because when Adonai added on the sacrificial system at Sinai, he made a covenant with the tribe of Levi. He made a covenant with them. That covenant has not been fully fulfilled yet. He's made promises to them. And so you can see that also in Malachi chapter 2. And again, you'll see that in Jeremiah chapter 33. Also read Ezekiel chapter 40 through chapter 48. That's talking about the millennial time, the temple and the millennial era of when Yeshua returns. There will be sacrifices and the Levitical priests will be going on, but it will be done in a holy way. Yeshua will be there overseeing it. And so there will not be any more corruption within it. It will be done in the way that Adonai intended it to be done. And he will have righteous priests ministering before him. And then also, just because that is done in the flesh, that is the fleshly priesthood, it is not of the same power and strength of the priesthood after Yeshua, because that is done by the Spirit. And so the fact that we are after the order of Melchizedek, as it is said, we are after Yeshua and his priesthood done in the Spirit, it doesn't contradict the two. The two can coexist one with another because the Levitical priesthood points us to the Melchizedek priesthood. It points us to that we need a more perfect priesthood than that, that we need something done by the Ruach HaKodesh. So again, it's no contradiction. It doesn't hurt one another because the shadow and types of the Levitical priesthood will help teach us and will help learn the ways of Adonai, pointing us to Yeshua. Amen. And then it will teach us, it has that boundary set up so that if you start interpreting the Torah incorrectly, it will go against that whole spirit of the law there, the intent and purpose of that law. So one way, when you are interpreting the Brit Hadashah, the New Covenant scriptures, when you interpret a scripture, it will never violate the Torah if you are interpreting it correctly. If your interpretation violates the Torah, it's not something different with the Torah, it's your interpretation, okay? So something we have to continue to remember as we're going through these passages here. So that is why Shaul can say, though myself not under the law, I am not under the penalty of the law. Amen. So getting back here to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, let's go on to verse 21. So that I might win those who are under the law. To those who are without law, he's just speaking to those that are outside of a covenant relationship with Adonai. They're outside the law of Moshe, all right? He also says here, as to those who are without law, as without law, though not being without the law of God, without the law of Moshe. The law of God is the law of Moshe, but being under the law of Christ. Okay, so let's go ahead and explain that. So in the beginning here, he says to those who are without law, they are right now, they're living in just a total pagan life. They are not walking in the laws of Moshe. He's going to teach them about Yeshua. He's going to teach them about a savior because Yeshua didn't just die for Israel. He died for the entire world. So he's going to set himself in their shoes. He's going to preach the message to them, to a people who don't know anything about Torah. So he needs to explain it in a certain way, in a certain fashion, so that they can understand it. He's got to go back to 101, like as if they were, you know, infants or babies learning the Torah. You know, within Judaism, you began to learn Hebrew and learn the Torah at age 5. That's when they would begin to teach their children the Torah. And so you're going all the way back to that time. That's kind of how you're going to be approaching this, is what Shaul is doing to those that don't know Torah. They're outside of Torah, all right? And he says, though not being without the law of God. The law of God reigns over all the earth, whether you know it or not, amen? We look at Romans chapter 1. So go with me to Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness. What determines what is ungodly and unrighteous? The law of Moshe. It teaches you what unrighteousness is. It teaches you what righteousness is. All right. So verse 18. For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness and unrighteousness of men. When you break the Torah, what do you receive? Wrath, right? You receive the curse of the Torah. Okay, you receive curses on your life, your community, your family. Let's go on. In unrighteousness, they suppress the truth. By them violating the Torah, though they don't even know about the Torah in that way, they are still suppressing the truth. Okay? Because what can be known about God is plain to them, for God has shown it to them. What is plain that there is a God that you must find and search for and come underneath his authority? What it is plain to them. What is that? Well, verse 20 tells us, his invisible attributes, his eternal power, and his divine nature have been clearly seen ever since the creation of the world, being understood through the things that have been made. So any pagan out there is still under God's law because it is already inside of him that when he looks at creation, he should at minimum recognize that a God created all of this. And that he needs to find out who that God is and come under his authority because of the beautifulness of creation, the beautifulness of himself that God created him. He must find this God and come under his authority because this is his place. This earth is the Lord's. And so he's suppressing that truth by doing what he wants, by ignoring that. And so the wrath of God sets on him. Amen. And so that is exactly what happens with all paganism. Though they are living outside of the law of Moshe, they're not living underneath it. They're still under his wrath because they should at minimum be searching out who God is through his creation. Amen. So it says here at towards the end of verse 20, it says, so people are without excuse. All right. So even though they knew God, they did not glorify him as God or give him thanks. Instead, their thinking became futile and their senseless hearts were made dark. All right. The more they suppress the truth, the more increase of the futileness in their minds and their hearts becoming dark became. They're under the wrath of Adonai. They're living outside of his laws, his Torah. Amen. Well, some people will say, yeah, but the law was given at Sinai. There was no law prior to that. I would encourage you, the law to some degree was always around, all right? All you have to do is go to Genesis, Bereshit, chapter 26, verse 5, and it shows that Abraham, he followed all of Adonai's instructions and his Torah there. The Hebrew word there for law or laws in general. Torot in Hebrew, meaning more than one, all of them, it's the Torah. All right, Adonai does not change. What is righteous. And so he would have been teaching orally to Abraham ways of Torah. And Abraham kept them. You know, he recognized that covenant relationship he has with Adonai and he submitted himself to him. When Adonai came to Abraham, Abraham had the faith. He believed, yes. There is a God. All right. I need to leave home, leave my father's house. They walk in unrighteousness. They walk in idolatry. I need to go follow after Adonai, the God that created all things. So that faith was a gift. He wasn't circumcised at that time either. He was not circumcised. Adonai didn't ask him to be circumcised until he already had the faith to leave. And so he entered into that covenant relationship. So again, when we go back to Galatians chapter 1, or I'm sorry, 1 Galatians chapter 9, verses 20 through 21, we see that when he says those that are without law, though they were not without the law of God, we can see they were still under God's law, though they were not recognizing it. They were not acknowledging it. Amen. And so if there is a chance for anyone to in their hearts, they begin to see, wow, there is a God. You know, I can see creation, I can see, but I don't know who this God is. If anyone were to begin to do that, because I believe that's placed in all men everywhere, if they begin to believe in that and begin to acknowledge that, I believe that Adonai will send an angel, Yeshua will go and maybe appear, you know, himself to that person or that tribe or that place on the earth that is beginning to recognize it. If there is a chance for someone to be saved, come under Yeshua, then the Ruach HaKodesh will do it. He will do it. I don't believe, because I know that Adonai doesn't want anyone to perish. So if there's any chance of someone being saved, then the work of Adonai will get it done. Amen. It won't be done by man's efforts, though God uses man to bring about the kingdom in people's lives. He uses us as an instrument. We're called to be that instrument. We are not the only instrument he can use. Amen. So going back to 1 Corinthians chapter 9, I realize there's a lot to explain within this passage, but it is because it is often misunderstood. But so we see here, let me read this again, verse 21, to those who are without law as without law, though not being without the law of God, but under the law of Christ. Now, we've been speaking again this whole time that under the law is huponamo, all right? But what we have here is a mistranslation of the Greek, okay? We have a mistranslation of the Greek because the Greek actually says here, when it says under the law of Christ, it's not a different law than Moshe, all right? The law of Moshe. It actually says here, and namos Christos. And namos Christos. All right. That actually, the Young's translation has it correct when they actually say within the law to Christ. So it's within the law of Moshe to Christ. All right. Yeshua did not come to abolish the law. He came to show us how to properly live the law of Moshe correctly. All right, and then in doing that, that's what the Ruach HaKodesh now does. He teaches you the law of Moshe, how to follow it correctly, so that you are indebted to Christ, to Mashiach, for your sins, for the sins that you have committed, so that you are indebted for when you fall short of the law of Moshe and not keeping it. You now look to Yeshua as your sacrifice for your sin. Amen. And so the law of Moshe is perfectly in effect here. It is perfectly within the law to Moshe. We are in the law of Moses today, Moshe, and we are dedicated to Yeshua through that. We follow in the way he taught and lived, and we use his sacrifice for our sins. So oftentimes within Western Christianity, and even those that misunderstand Shaul within the Messianic community, see, Shaul is teaching there are two different laws. There's the law of Moshe, and then there's the law of Christ. Those are two different laws. I no longer have to follow the law of Moshe, but I just follow the law of Christ. That is a total misunderstanding of the scriptures here. Amen. When you see the Greek, you will know it's not huponamon. It is enamon Christo, or Christos in some translations. And so within the law to Christ. Amen. Very important. So, no confusion here. Shaul, if you understand his law, the terminology, how it's used at this time in this setting, totally clears up the misunderstanding. Amen. So now let's move on to the next one, which is in Romans chapter 2, verse 12. Romans chapter 2, verse 12. For all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. Amen. So again, very similar to what we were seeing there in Romans chapter 1 verse, because this is again in Romans chapter 2, so he's carrying on that theme. So again, for all who have sinned without the law, all right, without the law of Moshe, being in that community of believers, being within the community of Israel who were given the law of Moshe. Just because the law of Moshe was given to Israel does not mean those outside are not under Adonai's law. Amen. What was Israel supposed to be? A light to the nations. Okay. What did it say in Deuteronomy? Let's go to chapter 4, Deuteronomy chapter 4. Start with verse 5. Start with verse 5. See, just as Adonai my God commanded me, I have taught you statutes and ordinances to do in the land that you are about to enter to possess. You must keep and do them, for it is your wisdom and understanding in the eyes of the people who will hear all these statutes and say, surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people. For what great nation is there that he has gods so near to them? And as Adonai our God is whenever we call on him. What great nation is there that has statutes and ordinances that are righteous, like all of this Torah that I am setting before you today? So he is fully aware that as they follow the Torah, it will draw the nations. They will see the righteousness that is within this nation, the goodness and blessings that Adonai gives this nation, and then it will draw them in, those that are without law. Because the reason why they need to do this and draw the other nations is though they don't have the law of Moshe in their community and in their countries, they are still under the wrath of Adonai. They are under the sin of Adam. They are still breaking his laws by all their sexual morality, their pagan ways, all right? Because they should be searching out God by just creation alone, and they're suppressing that truth. So they're still under his law. They're still under his law. Amen. So it was the job of Israel to be a light to the nations, and they failed in that commission. And Yeshua came along, and then he succeeded in rightfully dividing the word of truth, showing them, raising up Talmudim, the 12 apostles, and then he sent them out. He sent them out. And then what did he do with Shaul? He commissioned Shaul to be one of his, and he sent him out. And Shaul is a true apostle of Adonai. Amen. He has a different mission than the 12, different calling than the 12, and he will receive a different reward, but he is classified as an apostle on what an apostle is defined in Second Temple Judaism. So again, back to Romans chapter 2, verse 12, for all have sinned without the law, will also perish without the law. They will sin because there's nothing that has delivered them from the sin of Adam. And there are basic laws out there that that even show that there is a God. So they will be judged by not acknowledging what God had created inside of them, to acknowledge that there is a God. Everyone is born with that type of faith. There is a certain measure of faith that you are born with that gives you enough acknowledgement to show that there is a God and that you need to start searching him out. That's not something that the other nations did. They suppressed the truth. They neglected it. They didn't teach their children about that truth, that it was passed on and passed on. So they're not going to be judged exactly according to the law of Moshe in the same way that those who are under the law or been following the law of Moshe will be judged. But they still are sinners, and they still have violated laws of Adonai. So for all who have sinned without the law will also perish without the law, and all who have sinned under the law will be judged by the law. All right, you will receive a stricter law. Now here again, in the Greek, you have en namo. So the last half of this verse, all who have sinned in the law, is actually what it should say, will be judged by the law. So the better rendering there, because it is en namo, just like it was over with that passage pointing to Yeshua, where it says en namo Christo, it is here again, en namo. So all who have sinned in the law will be judged by the law. That's the better rendering here. Amen. So again, no contradiction. We already know that people who were pagans, considered pagans, they were going to be judged by Adonai. That was well known within Israel, that the pagans were going to be judged, even though they weren't under the law of Moshe. They hadn't been given that covenant relationship, but they were suppressing the truth. All right, they were suppressing the truth that there is a God. All right, and they were denying that. So they were going to be judged by that, the fact that they were denying Adonai. That is, there's no way for them to be delivered from the sin of Adam and from their sins alone too. So again, no contradiction. Shaul is just an amazing apostle. He's an amazing teacher that he now is receiving this revelation and teaching this from the Ruach HaKodesh after the resurrection, spending time with the Ruach HaKodesh. He's receiving this knowledge. Now in Romans chapter 3, verse 19, Romans chapter 3, verse 19, we see this. Now we know that whatever the law says, it speaks to those who are under the law. Okay. Again, entu namo. All right. In other words, in the law, who are in it, right? Have that covenant relationship with Adonai. All right. They're in it. So that every mouth may be closed and all the world may become accountable to God. So God has given them this law of Moshe, this Torah, and because they are underneath it, everyone can see the penalty that comes by for those that break it, all right? The sacrificial system shows it. When they ignore the sacrificial system, what happens to them? The wrath of God remains on them. When they get scattered from being disobedient from Adonai, why did they get scattered? They weren't following the Torah correctly. They're under its penalty. They're under it, and they're under its penalty. It's multifaceted here. Who are under the law, but it's actually not huponamon here. It is entu namon, okay, into the law or in the law, so that every mouth may be closed. If Adonai will punish them for not obeying the law that he gave them, how much more will it happen to those who are suppressing the truth that Adonai even exists, that there even is him as their creator and as their God? If they suppress that, they can't even go to the next step to receive the righteous laws of Adonai, to have that covenant relationship. And so in our minds, we think, well, yeah, so he shouldn't hold them accountable. He shouldn't. If someone never gets the chance to hear the words of Yeshua or hear the message of the gospel, the love of the Father, then they shouldn't be judged for that. But yes, they are, because everyone is born with a certain knowledge of knowing that there is a God, there is a creator. And it is our jobs to search that out. All right. He's given us a free will. The Yetzer Hara, the Yetzer Tov. All right. That makes up our free will. Yetzer Hara is your evil inclination. The Yetzer Tov is your good inclination. And you have that war, that battle inside of you. What are you going to follow? What are you going to follow? The good inclination is trying to get you to recognize there is a creator, there is a God. There's no way this all just happened through evolution and through just happened by chance. That everything here was done by the hand of a creator. And that should be enough for you to begin to search him out. And I totally believe no matter what part of the earth you are on, whether a man was able to bring the gospel to you or not, if that arises inside of you, that Adonai will make a way. He'll send an angel. Yeshua will show up himself. Somehow, some way, Adonai will save you because he desires for the entire world to be saved. Amen. And if he doesn't send somebody, if that part of the earth, for whatever reason, never hears the gospel, it was because they were suppressing the truth that was already within them. Amen. And that is up to Adonai to judge. That's not our place to judge. All right, and the last one we want to look at is Romans chapter 6, verses 14 to 15. Romans chapter 6, verses 14 to 15. This is the last one we'll look at, and then we will close this teaching. The next teaching, again, we will pick up and do works of the law. Works of the law, and that terminology and what that means. So Romans chapter 6, verse 14 and 15. For sin shall not be master over you. For you are not under the law, but under grace. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law, but under grace? May it never be. May it never be. So when you have the proper understanding that under the law here is multifaceted, it means that you are not under the penalty of the law any longer because the blood of Yeshua is paid that price. That means that power of sin does not reign over you. That means that you should not allow it to have mastery over you again. You are filled with the Ruach HaKodesh, And if you rely on him, he will empower you not to come under that penalty of the Torah again. So, for sin shall not be master over you. Now that you are on this side of the cross, you are filled with the Ruach HaKodesh. All right, you shall not allow it to master you. All right, for you are not under its penalty anymore. You are not under its power anymore. You are under grace. All right, now under grace does not mean without law. Right? What shall we say then? Shall we sin because we are under, not under the penalty of the law, under the law, but under grace? Now, grace is just the provision for you to enter into the kingdom. It is the sacrifice of Yeshua that allows you into the kingdom, and the sacrifice of Yeshua allows you to continually apply that blood to your sins. That was given to you not because you did something great to earn it, not because you had the capability of winning God's favor over so he could give you this the sacrifice of Yeshua and let you apply it to your sins. You didn't earn it. No, he gave it to you through your faith. You put your faith and trust in the work of Yeshua, all right? And you repented. You recognized that that is what you need for your sins. That's what you need to have applied through the penalty of breaking Adonai's word, his Torah. And so that was given to you by grace, all right? So you are under grace, meaning you've been given that gift of salvation. You've been given that entrance into the kingdom. And that gift of salvation, that blood of Yeshua, is now going to be applied every time you break the law of Moshe, every time you go to follow it, when you break Sabbath, when you break one of the laws concerning the feasts, when you break the law concerning loving your neighbor as yourself, when you break any of the laws concerning loving God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. The blood of Yeshua is applied to every law that you break now. That was a gift of grace because it's permanently done away with. It's not on a temporary basis anymore. The blood of bulls and goats only temporarily held it. It was like a credit card again. It just was waiting for the one that could make the full payment. Amen. And now you have it. Now you have this gift of grace. And so does it mean that you are without the law of Moshe? No. Because that shows you what righteousness is. That tells you what the character of Adonai is, what his demands are of all those who are in his kingdom. We are doing kingdom living here, all right? And kingdom living means following the law of Moshe, amen? And now it's not going to be a burden for you. It's not going to be too heavy for you because the Ruach HaKodesh will show you in a way that is light, amen? Yeshua says, take on my yoke. For my yoke is light, my way of following the Torah. My teachings teach you the righteous ways of the Torah without being a heavy burden or a weight. You can keep Sabbath in the way that Yeshua kept Sabbath. You can keep the festivals in the way that Yeshua kept the festivals. Amen? And it wasn't a heavy burden, but they are still the laws. They're the laws of the kingdom. Amen? So again, let's read this again. For sin shall not be master over you, for you are not under the law, penalty of the law, but under grace. You've been given the blood of Yeshua to apply to your sins. What then? Shall we sin because we are not under the law? So if you want to interpret the law as we're no longer under the law, then that means you can go out and commit adultery. You can go out and commit whatever type of sin you want. You can lie, steal, cheat. Do it all because you have grace. Because you have grace. No, Paul makes it clear. The law of Moshe is not done away with. It's not that you have the freedom to just go ahead and sin now. Break all those laws. Break Sabbath. Break the feast day laws. No, you just now have the permanent sin offering. The one that can do away with the power of sin in your life. That does not give you the freedom to sin. Amen. Because Adonai knows the heart of a man. And if you turn around and walk in that type of heart, that type of mindset, then according to Hebrews, there remains no more sacrifice for you. Amen? So if we deliberately go on sinning, and we basically blaspheme the cross, there will remain no more sacrifice for you. It cannot be applied because the true heart of repentance is not in you. And so you need that true heart of repentance in order for that gift of grace to be applied to your life. You need to begin to turn, listen to the Ruach HaKodesh. Allow him to lead you into the truths of the Torah. Put up those boundaries all around your life that the Torah teaches, so that you remain pure and holy, because Adonai is coming back for a pure bride. He's coming back for a people without spot and wrinkle, ones that constantly apply the blood of Yeshua to their sins, and they don't go around just constantly repeating the same sins blatantly in their lives anymore. Amen. And so that's the type of person Yeshua is expecting to come to, that type of bride, when he returns. Amen. So again, no contradiction to Shaul. Just place him in the proper setting. Place him in the proper context. These are letters written to a specific people at a specific place and time in a specific culture. We must place that right back. We must understand the slang terms of that time. Under the law was a multifaceted type of meaning. It meant under the law of Moshe, and it also meant under the penalty of that, because that's what the law of Moshe points to, is the penalties that are due those who break the Torah. Amen. So I hope this was helpful for you. We will go on again, as I shared, to do the term works of the law and understand that term within Second Temple Judaism on our next part. And we'll see where the Ruach HaKodesh leads us. I'm planning on that being the last of this teaching series. But we will see. We'll see what the Ruach does in the meantime. And if he leads us to go on farther, we'll do another part. Amen. So as always, when we go to end any of these discussions, we want to always end with the Aaronic blessing, because the goal of living in the kingdom and being in the kingdom is so that Adonai's name will rest on you. Amen. He wants his name to rest on you because you represent him living in the kingdom. Amen. So the Aaronic blessing is found in Bamidbar, Numbers chapter 6, verses 24 through 26. And if you know this, go ahead and join in with me. Yevarechecha Adonai ve'yishmerecha, Ya'er Adonai pa'anav elecha ve'unecha, Yasa Adonai pa'anav elecha ve'yaseh lecha shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord's face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. Shalom, everyone.